results arrive for the 4-week competition in Nigeria. Julia Morley's gamble is underway.
They were actually bending their knees to us, you know, they were cheering at us, they were screaming at us, and just like we were movie stars. If we had come to Norway, no one would have done such a thing like that.
Tight skirts and Ramadan do look as if they're going together, despite the fears beforehand about the objections in a country that is half Muslim.
We obviously were flaunting our bodies, I guess, in vests and shorts, but the Nigerians we met were so excited for us to be there that we didn't feel that we were intruding or doing anything wrong at the time.
But Nigeria was already known to the world as the place where a woman had just been sentenced to death by stoning for adultery.
The security was immense. People with guns everywhere, a lot, you know, lots of the army, like lining the route to the hotel. It's just quite scary. What are they expecting, really?
When we went out in any trip at all, there would be about 6 police cars on either side of the buses, and on one occasion I think there was actually a police bomb squad van that was following us around, and it was, you know, we were all like, do you need that, you know?
Outside the hotel, the beauty queens may have found security overwhelming, but inside, it was suffocating.
It was just one incident. I asked you for many of your questions. You didn't have anything. Stop. If you can't do it, whatever, you know, but just try your best once, please.
Your life is controlled and dictated by the chaperone. If you wanted to go down from our rooms, we had to tell visit our friends, like the other contestants in another room, we had to tell our chaperone. Being independent almost all my life, I was definitely very frustrated. I thought, you know, this woman's just going to ruin my life.
This was not what a 24-year-old from a rich family, educated at boarding school in England, university in Paris, and studying for a master's degree in America, expected from Miss World.
It was just like little Hitlers running around all day. I had to ask permission to go to the toilet even, and she would have to stand directly outside my cubicle and wait for me to finish. Turned a strict parental 24-hour control.
Well, you tell them what we're allowed to do.
Not a whole lot without a chaperone.
This is my chaperone, kid.
The whole time we were constantly being watched. The chaperone's number one priority was to watch us and report back to Julie Morley every night and tell her individually each girl and which girls are giving trouble, which girls aren't getting along with the other girls.
A lot of the girls say to me, you're being watched from day one, so be on your best behavior. Be aware of what you're doing. Never lose your temper, never be out of track. Giggly, smiling 24 hours a day, always cheerful, always happy, and I just felt it was fake. I felt that, you know, they thought it was an image they had to portray in order to perhaps win the crown.
The girls knew the bottom line was they were in a competition and the point was to win it. And if that meant sitting in their hotel rooms, not glamorous sightseeing trips, then they had to accept it.
For about 95% of the time, we were locked up in our bedrooms.
Call your embassy!
It just felt like you were waiting for never to arrive. That's how a couple of the girls described it.
So we would just eat junk food and biscuits and chocolate because we had nothing else to do.
I just sort of like ate chocolate bars every day and got fat. That's it.
Average contestant put on about 10 pounds.
So that was a lot, so we don't feel good, especially in a beauty contest.
For girls who were naturally fanatical about their appearance and trained every day, the answer was obvious. Go to the gym. At Miss World, this surprisingly became a very real problem.
I'm going to be, you know, in front of 2 billion viewers. I want to be looking my best. So the next day I asked, they said, oh, no, you can't. It's too much of a problem. For security reasons, you know, you can't. So I think I used the gym once in the whole of the month, and that was such a problem.
Area confident, but soon felt undermined.
And you go into the room and you find this whole bevy of beauties and you're thinking, my goodness, what am I doing here? It's like before I always thought I had a small waist, but then you go and see a much smaller waist and you go like, oh my god, I thought mine was absolutely perfect. Or you think you've got a cute butt and you go and see a much cuter butt and you're like, oh my god, that's even more perfect.
But some of the girls have been made more perfect.
A lot of these girls, especially the South Americans, had come with a lot of plastic surgery. Miss Peru had fake breasts and she told me I could, you know, feel them. And these girls were very proud of what they had done. That was part of their prizes, their national prizes in those countries.
I know that Miss Brazil, she could have any surgery that she wants. So she got new boobs, she got new nose. She told me herself, in fact, that she could ask anything.
All over CNN.
Michelle woke her roommate, Miss Belgium.
And I watched the news all night long. People was dying, and they were saying it's because of us, because we were in this country. I didn't want to provoke that kind of thing, so I was feeling really bad. I went to Miss Scotland's room, and her chaperone was there. And her chaperone, she put me out of the room because she said that I was scaring her by saying her the truth.
I think by this time they saw Miss Belgium just as a troublemaker. As far as I was concerned, you know, quite rightly, bringing up something very important and something I had to deal with and face and make a decision about.
So I went to Julia Morley and I said, do you know what's going on? She wasn't that informed. She apparently didn't know exactly what was going on. At that point, I'd made up my mind, but I was leaving one way or another.
By the morning, Julia Morley had a crisis on her hands. But Julia's address to the girls seemed to focus as much on Miss Belgium as it did on the dangers.
She told us that, I know that Miss Belgium is very upset at what's happening, but we don't have to worry what's happening. Your safety is guaranteed. Riots here happen all the time. And this is just an excuse to riot again, so you don't have to feel guilty about it. Some girls feel a lot better after Mrs. Morley talked to them, but I didn't really. I thought that was a bad excuse to say that it was happening all the time.
You hear of riots and things like that on and off, so on one hand you're thinking, well, have you not been there when the 100 people would be killed? But then you're thinking, well, wait, not for us, they'll find another reason.
Both Canada and Korea went home. The British girls decided they would follow.
Really thinking in my head, no, love me, love me.
On the other hand, the show's portrait of Miss Australia was more accurate.
Australia!
Australia looked so pleased because, unlike some fellow contestants, she really wanted to win. She eventually was placed, but only sixth. Coming from a rich and shrewd Lebanese business family in Sydney, Nicole used her time at the Miss World contest to find out how it works.
A country like Australia wouldn't do very well in a pageant because it has no TV rights and Miss World doesn't even show in Australia. And so the license of Australia costs, I think, around $25,000, which Julie Morley earns. The license, for example, in Venezuela can sell up to $1 million, where it's a huge pageant and, you know, a lot of people are fighting to own the license. Every country is Julia Morley. When the final winners were announced, it wasn't a shock to me because I could see the logic behind choosing every girl.
People's Republic of China.
Viewers of the Miss World finals saw Grace, Beauty and Poise win Miss China fifth place. Nicole saw a business plan in operation.
I come from China.
With a viewership of 2.5 billion people in China alone, you'd be stupid not to pick her in the top five.
Miss Peru.
Viewers saw Julia Morley go on to announce this beautiful South American girl as the winner of third place. Nicole again saw something else.
I believe that her decisions are mainly based on a business point of view, and I can understand why.
In second place, Miss Colombia.
From what I'd heard, that they were looking to renew the contracts of the licenses in both of those countries. And Julie and Morley wanted to push the rate in some of those particular countries.
This world, 2002, is Miss Turkey.
The excitement at the show has built to this moment when, as always, Julia Morley has the honour of revealing the winner. It was a choice Nicole and others had seen coming.
Miss Turkey was a Muslim girl and fit in perfectly after all the problems that we've had in Nigeria.
I knew Miss Turkey would win, but I only knew it the last day of the contest. I knew she would win because it just made the most sense. She was Muslim, she was beautiful, she was very tractable and docile. Don't forget, Miss World is shown largely in the third world. Obviously, it benefits Miss World.
Is Miss Turkey.
The excitement at the show has built to this moment when, as always, Julia Morley has the honour of revealing the winner. It was a choice Nicole and others had seen coming.
Miss Turkey was a Muslim girl and fit in perfectly after all the problems that we've had in Nigeria.
I knew Miss Turkey would win, but I only knew it the last day of the contest. I knew she would win because it just made the most sense. She was Muslim, she was beautiful, she was very tractable and docile. Don't forget, Miss World is shown largely in the third world. Obviously, it benefits Miss World to have a third world winner if you're shown in the third world.
In the last 10 years, 7 winners have been from the third world. Julia Morley and the judges.